How's it going, New World? Sephir here, and today we are going to be taking a look at Outpost Rush and the strategies that you can do to win, especially when you are solo. So here I have queued by myself with no one else whatsoever, and I'm going to show you how to sort of shift the battle into your favor using the PvE mechanics within the Outpost Rush. So at the start, I have a light armor roll. I just took off a few pieces of my armor just so that I can be more mobile, and I am rocking the bow build. I will put a quick information on that, but essentially you just take all the bow talents that increase movement speed when you roll. As you can see here at the start, this is normal walking speed. So I did this to demonstrate how fast you move with the bow. As you can see, when I roll, I get a double buff, and then the axe allows me to get a charge off, which will increase the distance that I am running. There are a few things, and a lot of people tend to go for like these weird areas in this direction, right? Like going where I'm at right now is not the best place to go. In my opinion, there is a strategy that wins this game, and I think it will evolve over time with the meta, but for now, this works. And that is going to be getting Azoth. And Azoth is very important for a lot of reasons, but the main reason that it is important is that you can summon a giant brute that is elite in front of the bases, and the brute has all kinds of stuns, tons of damage. He's just a giant monstrosity to deal with. And it takes a fully coordinated 5 to 10 man group to take that boss down in front of the base. And that just gets worse when you defend that boss, because he's gonna pull everyone in, he's gonna AoE stun, he's gonna throw boulders, and he's a nightmare. He really is. So getting control of this objective is gonna be your prime go-to strat, especially for solo queue, because a lot of people are just running around like chickens with their heads cut off and pretty much farming wood or fighting people to the death, having one-on-one battles in the middle of nowhere for no apparent reason. So there are things in this game that are worth doing, and this is one of the bosses that is worth doing. This is Ugg. I believe the other one on the other side of the map, who is a mines boss as well, is called Doug. So Doug and Ugg. But when you kill them, they drop a Banshee stone or a Wraith stone, as you can see there, plus a generous amount of Azoth. So right now what I'm doing is I'm trying to get to 500 Azoth so that I can go to the corrupted portal to turn in my Azoth to summon the brute. And that is my big objective. So you can do this by heading to the mines, because there's a lot of enemies there. You can also pick up that Banshee token, which is another summon that you can have. And remember that Baron does not unlock for the first 10 minutes, so it's going to be a little while before the Baron will be in play. So your best use of time here is collecting Azoth resources. Once I get enough where I feel that I have enough to get Diablo, I'm going to head to the other side of the map. And this is just me personally. Me solo, I have 325 Azoth, and the score is still 30 to 20, right? The game has barely begun yet. It's very fortunate my team happens to be winning right now, which is great, but I can really sort of win this game almost by myself with the summons and placing them in the right place, doing a backdoor with a giant Diablo summon on their main base, or even just using that Diablo to get lock control of the midpoint, which is very good in more close games where Baron is a thing, because Baron is the highest priority in this game, and you need to be there as soon as it spawns, because it completely shuts down the enemy team's score for 3 minutes, which makes it really hard to come back. So just keep that in mind, that your biggest priority is always going to be Baron, but if Baron is not up, it is going to be summoning the big Diablo looking guy, the brute, the elite brute, which is exactly where I'm heading right now. So I'm going to go ahead and head over here and collect a few more Azoth along the way so that I know I have enough. And then I am going to get this Diablo Brute token, and we're going to go ahead and place it on the battlefield, and then you can start to see what happens. And this is like, that's where the magic is going to happen, right? So again, the big priority is going to be getting, Baron if it's up, Azoth if Baron is not up, and then you can focus on other things. But in my opinion, the bases are the way to go. They seem to give about 1 point every 3 seconds for each base that you control, or maybe a little bit more or less for that. There's like some sort of point generation. We're trying to measure it right now. We'll have some full details later in a full outpost rush guide, but for now we just have like a minimal one. Do be careful when you're gathering out, because as you can see, this guy here really wanted to kill me, but I'm too fast, so I'm gonna be able to get away. Because if he does kill me, he can take my Azoth. However, if you do have the tokens, those are not droppable, so the tokens will be permanently in your inventory. So as we go here, I'm trying to scout out this middle base, because this is the one contention point that's important to control for the middle of the map. And I don't want to summon the Diablo at this one, because it's behind. It's where my team is coming from. I want to summon it ahead of the pack, like ahead of where their team is going to be rushing into this middle fort from. And I believe I get it off over here with a little bit of dancing and ignoring this little mage guy here. We are able to summon the Diablo really quickly. And this is where the chaos starts to happen. I can now fight around Diablo by myself and generate a lot of problems for the enemy team. So I'm going to slap my armor back on here, find my correct boots, and put on my real weapon instead of the bow just for travel speed. And then I'm going to get to business here. I'm going to start taking out these people. As you can see, they just got pulled in by the Diablo. Diablo is going nuts right now. He's just running around super tanky, smacking people down, and he also is going for the gate. So keep that in mind. So I'm now fighting around Diablo. Here comes the giant boulder stunning everyone and pushing them back. He's just beating players down, and my team can rally around this, right? They don't know what to do because they're all getting yanked back in with the Diablo yet again, and he's just doing work on their team. So from this point on, we have control of this base until they deal with this Diablo. They just don't know that yet because the Diablo is just generating so much power in that front hold there that no one can really fight us. So if we just fight around this guy, we can easily break into the fort and clean them up in the middle. He will also set at the gate and pull people from the middle to him and shoot boulders into the base. So it gets even worse. So it is almost impossible to take a base with a Diablo just sitting there wreaking havoc on your team. And that's going to be the importance of it. So the other applications that you can do with this is that you can take this summoning stone, and as a solo player, I can run to their base, like the opposite side of the base, and I can summon one of these monsters and just start beating on their gate. And that's going to alert the enemy team. They're going to be like, oh no, our base is under attack. Let's go stop this guy. But the thing is, with health potions and fighting around the Diablo stuns, it's going to be incredibly hard for anybody to deal with just one person and a giant Diablo. They're going to have to commit multiple players, and they're going to lose control of the map when they do that. So here, I'm going to take my second summoning stone that I got later, the Banshee Stone, and I'm going to attempt to backdoor the enemy's base. And as you can see, they're kind of on the back foot now, because we got a good staple foothold in middle with the Diablo. So he's basically protecting that base. They need to deal with him before they can do anything else. And if I can put further pressure by summoning another summon on the back of their base, I can then deal with other players too. So either way, this is going to be a great distraction and a good use of my time, right? So you need to play around the mechanics of the game. It's not just go out in the middle and start fighting things, right? I think of this play mode like League of Legends, almost. It's very similar, actually. So there's a lot of micro and macro that needs to happen within the game, besides just, you know, fighting people to the death over the point. Like, that's the bare minimum, like, expectation of what's going on here. This Banshee in the back, the Wraith, does shoot attacks, and it kind of, like, teleports up on people and hits them with, like, a stun, and it does quite a lot of damage as well. I've seen it chunk players for half health. It does not have the most HP itself. There is another summon in the game called the Bear Summon, which does not also have a lot of HP as well. So keep that in mind, as those summons will be able to be killed, but the Diablo is just quite a problem for everyone, right? The other mechanics within the game are not super important right now. Building a gate can be destroyed very easily. Building some sort of a turret does not seem to do that much damage, although I will try to test it and upgrade it further. We tried to upgrade the command posts, and that seemed to give some sort of a damage and damage reduction buff, as well as passively generating like tokens or something, or Azoth for people to use. I'm not sure what was going on with it, but it seemed a little weird. We're going to try to fully test it and see what all happens. There is a pylon within the base that you can build that will allow your team to spawn there or have a respawn point. That one is decently useful, but all of these mechanics seem to fall short of the existence of Baron and Diablo within the game, because those are the two major important ones. If you have a Diablo, he can defend your base by himself. Like, he's basically a gate and a turret and all those other upgrades that you would have spent so much time chopping wood and farming metal to get. Not to say that there is not a place for that, because we still gotta fully test that. I'm interested to see how the meta evolves, and of course players will figure out things. Maybe an upgraded turret is the real deal, and no one can deal with it. Maybe it can kill Diablo. Maybe the oil is the way to go too. I'll continue testing, but Outpost Rush has really only been out for about a day, seriously, and I'm playing it non-stop to try to figure out exactly what the best way to go is. And there are better strategies that you can use for team play, but for solo play, I found that this is the best. For team play, allocating people to take control of certain points and generate Azoth is gonna be a really nice way to go. And as you can see, our team is on the fast track to winning here, because we have so much fort control with these summons that we can actually just fight, and they can't take any bases. They can't backcap, because Diablo will ruin their day. One person can defend with Diablo being there, and the Banshee as well. So we're free to just kind of duke it out. And as you can see on the top left of the screen here, we got this arrow thing. And I think this happens when you have control of all three bases. So it's kind of like a Wrathy Basin in WoW, where when you get control of everything, it starts dramatically increasing your score really quickly, and you win the game fast, right? So this is going to be a roughly 13 to 14 minute win. And if you can churn that out, that means you're going to get about 310 gold, as well as 250 Azoth. So you're going to be permanently swimming in Azoth. You can fast travel wherever and whenever you want. You can respec your weapons whenever you want. Outpost Rush has just been simply amazing. It's been fantastically fun, and I would love to see some sort of tuning for this and a leaderboard, perhaps. That would really nail it in for me. I would love to see this type of gameplay coming out. Maybe ranked queues, you could queue with a pre-made team, pre-mades versus pre-mades. All this stuff would be fantastic to see in the future. So I hope this kind of helps with everyone. I will go over in the next section of a like map layout. I'll probably do this in another video, actually, once I figure out more of what the exact meta is, but this should be a good starter. But just kind of use this to your advantage to snowball your games and make sure that everything goes well, because even if you're losing, summoning one of these giant monsters in the base can easily turn the tide of battle, and you can take your team from, you know, complaining in chat and losing all the way to just straight victory just by doing one simple thing, and the amount of impact you have as one player can be quite high. I'm sure the meta will change, and eventually we will see people contesting these zones very highly, and probably even with the information in this video, some people may be watching this, and that might be the contention point, will be that Diablo summoning stone. But for now, go ahead and take advantage of it. Use this trick to win more games so that you can get more gold, you can get more Outpost Rush boxes, and all kinds of other interesting things. And we can even go ahead and, as you see on screen here, is the resources that I gained from this. Since this was a quick win, the amount of gold was lowered. I have seen upwards to 250 Azoth and 360 gold. But as you can see here, I placed second. I don't know what the guy above me did, but healers tend to generate a lot of score. The scoring point system seems weird. It says I got 3 kills and 0 assists somehow, but I've contributed 310 resources. But the main factor going into it is this scoreboard's kind of irrelevant. It really just means that, I don't know. It's got some weird arbitrary point system where it tracks certain things and says that they're worth a lot of points. So I wouldn't pay too much attention to this. The big thing that you should take away from it is probably that winning the game doesn't necessarily scale towards being the top on the scoreboard here. So that's probably one thing to, take into account. So let's go ahead and skip forward here a little bit as we do see a bit of this stat screen. I will show you the box at the end of the screen here, because the box is important. People are getting 600 gear score items from these box. Some of them are legendary. Some of them have high watermark weapons and armor pieces in it. You can get quite lucky on these boxes. So this is a very viable gear farm as well as gold farm within the game. So this is probably one of the better ways, along with Mirgard portal farming, to really get your stuff scaling up. And as you can see, I got a 577 spear, a purple shield, and a 585 hat, so not too bad. I believe that spear was a watermark upgrade for me, so that is nice to see. So you will get a lot of good items here. So thanks for your time, everybody. Appreciate you watching. And we will come out with some more videos later on, giving the full meta dive of Outpost Rush and what you should do with a team or with solo. So be tuned for that info. And once again, if you enjoyed this content, be sure to subscribe, like, hit the bell. We also have a join button and a Discord membership. So go ahead and check those out and you can get some information. You can get in touch with me and you can just get involved in interacting with the New World community. Thanks for your time, everyone, and we will catch you in the next video.